As you're seated, if you would turn along with me to the Bible, to the Gospel of John, chapter 3. John, chapter 3, and if you don't have a Bible with you, you'll find a black hardback in the seat in front of you. I want to look at John, chapter 3. One of the great, many of you know, I've had health struggles over the last few months, and one of the great mercies of God, beginning in October, was restoring me to be able to preach and to minister and to serve. It is a great privilege and mercy in my life to be able to minister God's word to you. I'm going in for surgery on Wednesday, and so this will be the last time I'm in the pulpit for several weeks now. And covet your prayers, especially for just my heart to be back here and desire to do this again. And I thought, as we are focusing our minds on our coming and have our arrival of the Lord this Advent season, looking here at this critical conversation in John chapter 3 would be a fitting focus for our hearts and our meditations. We want to look at John chapter 3, verses 1 to 18. It is written, "Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, 'Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him.' Jesus answered him, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?' Jesus answered, 'Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit.' Nicodemus said to him, 'How can these things be?' Jesus answered him, 'Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God.'" This is the word of God. Let's pray together. Our God and Father, we praise you for your power and your might, not just in creation, but in recreating. And we bless you that you are able to change the leopard spots. You are able to change the heart of men. And we come to you, Father, with the expectation and the need and in total dependence of what is impossible. Impossible for any human to be changed in their heart towards you. Father, we depend on your grace. We know that with you all things are possible. And so we trust you and we pray that even today you would do your sovereign work in the hearts of those who are yet still born spiritually before you and have no life. And Father, we pray that you would revive your people continually, looking to you and Jesus. We pray that you would give us all ears to hear, and we pray for the one who preaches your word to be careful and clear, that you would be exalted in your Son Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. We use the word all the time in conversation. Society uses the word faith everywhere. We have faith, it will all work out. Have a little faith in yourself. We just need to take it on faith. It's a leap of faith. The way we use faith normally in conversation and speech indicates that what we typically mean by faith is some kind of empty confidence, some kind of vague aspiration or desire, or sometimes even a certainty that just really borders on superstition. So when Christians say, we have faith, or even maybe more importantly, God saves sinners by faith in his son Jesus alone, we wouldn't be surprised if using that word is easily misunderstood or even completely unintelligible, maybe even to those of us in the church. The truth is, though, the confusion about faith isn't a new problem. It's a very old problem. And even when the Lord Jesus came, there was confusion about what it meant to believe him, to believe in him, to have faith in him. Just look just above our passage here in John chapter 3 and verses 23 to 25 of chapter 2. We're told that verse 23, many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them because he knew all people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man. So we're told here by John that public interest in Jesus was high. He was popular, and many even believed in his name because of his signs. They were intrigued by his power. It was evident by the miracles he was doing, but ultimately, by Jesus' response in verse 24, that belief was superficial. Jesus didn't entrust himself to them. It was a mob who was excited about what Jesus could accomplish and what he could do, but they didn't really understand, they didn't really trust who he was. And the several conversations that follow here in this gospel, John is illustrating and unpacking this very point for us. And he's exposing how mistaken faith can be. If you skip over our text in chapter 3 and just glance over John chapter 4, we'll remember Jesus interacting with a Samaritan woman who in verse 19 perceives that Jesus is a prophet. But he'll go on to say he's far more. In verse 26, he is the long-awaited Messiah, the Christ himself. And then later in verse 48, we see Jesus in Galilee, but people again are just believing by signs and wonders. They're seeing his power, and that is the basis of their attraction, their faith in Jesus. And even as we go into chapter 5, the healing of the man at the pool of Bethsaida, he knows he was healed, but as he tells the Jews in verse 11, he has no idea who it was. Later in this chapter, John chapter 5, verse 24, Jesus will clarify that belief are those who believe are those who hear his word and believe his Father who sent him, believe the word of his Father. So as we go back to chapter 3, the whole context in this portion of John's gospel is driving at exposing real faith. What does it mean to really rely, trust in Jesus Christ? And it's introduced for us in verse 1 of chapter 3 with a man named Nicodemus, who is coming with just the same vague, unclear, uncertain faith as everyone else that is interacting with Jesus. But Jesus, we know, verse 25 of chapter 2, right before this, knows what's in man. And he's about to explain that to the man himself, to expose it for all of us. What does it really mean to trust him? And how is that different than what Nicodemus and all these others are interested in Jesus for? And I'm guessing that we could take it just for granted that as we gather this morning, we need this same revelation from Jesus, who knows what's in our hearts and needs to expose it. For undoubtedly, we also all have a variety of motivations and desires for inquiring about Christ and even Christianity. For some of us, it's tough circumstances that often drive that exploration. Maybe it's a job loss or financial distress, or maybe we're hoping that Jesus can fix our life that seems stuck. Others of us might be discouraged, just generally disappointed with life, depressed, and we're hoping that with Jesus we can find peace or wholeness and joy. Or perhaps we're suffering some great trial, physical illness or loss, pain, even the reality of our own mortality or those around us. And so it's causing us to think about God more and about what He has to say in Jesus Christ. The truth is, we can understand very much the people around Jesus in His day, as we all come to Him with different motives, different desires, different questions, many of which probably aren't even clear to us as we inquire about Him. And so we need Jesus Himself to clarify faith for us. What does it mean to trust Him? And that's what we have here in this text. The Holy Spirit speaks to us here of true faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, so that we'd rely on Him alone and that we would know real life and salvation in Christ. We have here a mixture in this passage of both bad news and really, really good news. And we have differentiated for us what it means to rely on the Word of Christ and upon Him. What I want us to do is work through three main sections in this conversation. We'll look at verses 1 to 10 and think about listening in desperation. In verses 9 to 15, we'll talk about looking for deliverance. And then briefly, we'll look at verses 16 to 18 and talk about living in dependence. Listen, look, live, as Jesus unpacks for us real faith in Him. Well, let's look at the bulk of this interaction between Jesus and Nicodemus in John 3, 1 to 10, listening in desperation. We're told that Nicodemus is not just any Jew inquiring about Jesus. He is of the Pharisees, in verse 1, a ruler of the Jews. That means he's a member of the Sanhedrin, one of the great council of religious and political decisions in Israel. He had real power and real influence. And that's why in verse 2 we're told he comes to Jesus by night. Not at night, but by night. He comes under the cloak of darkness because he's taking great risks as an influential and powerful man to be seen fraternizing with this somewhat unusual rabbi. So we can understand here that Nicodemus's questions are sincere. He's taking risks to be here and to speak to Christ. But he's skeptical. He knows, as he says in verse 2, that Jesus has come from God because no one can do those signs unless God is with him. But don't overemphasize that. You could say the same of any prophet. He's just acknowledging the fact that obviously God is doing something with you. What is it that Nicodemus wants? What's driving him to interact with Jesus? We have an insight in how Jesus begins the conversation in verse 3 about seeing the kingdom of God. You see, long ago, God promised His people a kingdom, a universal kingdom. He promised them freedom from all oppression. He promised them perfect justice. And these promises came in some of the darkest moments of Israel's history, when they were in exile, when they were under oppression and disciplined for their sins. And some of the most vivid promises of this kingdom come to us in the prophet Ezekiel. And in chapters 36 and 37 of that prophet, we see promises like God giving His people a kingdom. They would be ruled by a single king, descendant from the line of King David, their greatest king. God's people would be forgiven and restored to God for their sin. And God would be honored not just by Israel, but by the nations through this kingdom. So this is a kingdom God had promised unlike anything Israel had ever seen. Even the brightest points in their history don't even touch what God promised them. But also these promises, they'd been given 600 years ago. Six centuries of waiting. And God's people are still oppressed. They're still under pagans. It's not Babylonians anymore. Now it's Romans under the Roman Empire here in the first century. And you can imagine with all that waiting, all that social and even spiritual turmoil, debate raged among the Jews about how this kingdom was to come to pass, how it would happen. You had groups that we might call political and religious accommodators, like the Sadducees. They ran the temple complex and made a lot of money off of it. And so they accommodated with the Romans and even became partners with them. You had other groups like the Zealots, who were violent radicals, even terrorists, that thought by force and violence they would bring in God's kingdom and tear down the pagans, using violence even to do it. And then you have what we might call religious separatists. That's really where the Pharisees fit. Separating apart, waiting for God's kingdom, and seeing themselves as the most faithful, the most spiritual, the ones who certainly could expect God's promises to come for them. So we can understand here, Nicodemus is coming to Jesus to talk about this kingdom. And really, he's trying to size Jesus up. He's obviously doing these amazing things, and so Nicodemus wants to figure out, whose program is Jesus with? Whose agenda is he on? Whose camp, whose tribe is he in? Is he with us? Is he with the Sadducees? Who's he with? His power is undeniable, but what's his agenda? Why is he here? And I hope by just this little bit of context and background, we can all identify with Nicodemus. We still come to Jesus to see if he'll fit into our goals, into what we want. And we'll often examine him and his word through the lens of our concerns. Many will look to Jesus very, very personally, even as a therapist or as someone who has come to help them achieve their agenda and their aims for life. Or we might look to Jesus through our concerns and what we see in society and in our nation and think about how Jesus might help us restore and heal our political and social divides and our national problems. But really, the specifics are immaterial. The point is that since Jesus himself was walking on this earth to this very day, we still come to Jesus to get answers to our questions. And over and over and over again, Jesus in his ministry tries to change the question. Over and over again in his word, God communicates to us, you ask bad questions. You need to change your question. We see Jesus do that so many times, even as he does it here. Jesus makes very clear at the front of most of his conversations that he has not come to meet our needs as we see them, but he came to blow our understanding of what we need and what we think we need wide open and to change the questions we're asking. Nicodemus, like many of the Jews around him, wanted to know when and how God's kingdom was coming. When were God's promises going to come to pass? But they totally ignored a massive assumption that Jesus was going to blow wide open for Nicodemus. And the assumption was that they deserved God's kingdom and that it was automatically theirs. So Jesus explains to Nicodemus the question he should be asking. Verse 3, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus, you're not seeing any kingdom as you are. No one is. And he'll get more direct in verse 7 when he says, you all must be born again. And I say you all on purpose, and what's really important here in this conversation, and you probably have footnotes in your Bibles, is that the you here is plural. It's so unfortunate that we're not below the Mason-Dixon and we could just translate it and talk about y'all. Because the Bible has y'all everywhere. And Jesus is telling Nicodemus, y'all must be born again. Not just him, everyone. What Jesus is explaining here to Nicodemus and all he represents is that there is a universal condition to these promises. And it's that you all and everyone concerned about God's kingdom have to be born again. Now, another adjustment we want to make in translation, and you also have a footnote there in your Bibles on the again in verse 3, and it would be better and more literal to translate it from above, to be born from above. The reason we have again there is translators in the past preferred it because of Nicodemus's question in verse 4, suggesting that he understood Jesus asking as being born again. But it's safe to say in this conversation that Nicodemus isn't tracking well at all with Jesus. That's why Jesus will remark in verse 7, don't marvel, and in verse 12, talk about his unbelief. So we shouldn't take Nicodemus's question in verse 4 as really sincere. It's really more skeptical. When he asks, can a man enter a second time to his mother's womb, Nicodemus is basically saying, what are you, nuts? It's a kind of scornful question. No, the term is born from above, and every other place that this word shows up in the Gospel of John, it's translated as above, born from above. Now, why is that important, born again versus born from above? Well, it's important to clarify that because it really helps us shed of a lot of assumptions that we might bring to the phrase born again. All the things that have grown over that concept. Because often it gives the impression that being born again means a significant life change. Maybe you sobered up from addiction, or you were freed from an abusive relationship. There was a massive breakthrough in your life, and so you must have done got born again. Or maybe being born again refers to some kind of emotional crisis or psychological breakthrough. These types of things happen all the time in life, in all sorts of different settings. And oftentimes they have nothing to do with God or His Spirit. And there are times where you can be born from above and never know when that happens. Because maybe you're raised in a Christian home and you can't remember when you ever consciously rejected the gospel. And so we want to shed from our minds anything that's attached to the concept that born again is something merely external, obvious, emotional, psychological. Jesus isn't describing here turning over a new leaf. He's not describing feeling reborn. He's not describing a massive restart in life. In fact, really, the whole point that Jesus is getting at here is that he's not referring to anything that anyone can do or change themselves. That's the point, right? When he goes on in verse 6 and says, what is born of the flesh is flesh. And by flesh here in this conversation, Jesus just means our human nature, our physical selves. What do humans produce? They produce more humans. So Nicodemus, you are all discussing how people can bring in God's kingdom. And essentially the debate raging in his day with the Sadducees and the Zealots and the Pharisees and everyone else was all about how they were going to bring in the kingdom of God or their understanding of God's kingdom. And the thing that you're all missing is that all you can produce is more flesh. You can't bring this in. You need to be born from above. You see, this is not something that people can do. God has to do something. That's the point that Jesus is driving at. To enter God's kingdom, God has to process all who enter. We cannot bring ourselves into the kingdom of God. We cannot bring God's kingdom to us. And the reason is quite obvious. It's God's kingdom. It's His. And we're creatures, not creators. All that creatures can do is rearrange what's created. What is born of the flesh is flesh. Now, let's not overemphasize it. A lot can be done by rearranging flesh. You can really improve your life in many, many ways with education and help and improving bad habits and alleviating ignorance. There's a lot that can be done to rearrange flesh in our society. Things can be done better, with more efficiency, greater care, and justice. But whatever is done to rearrange the flesh will always only be temporal and always be shot through with imperfection. Theologian Charles Hodge wisely made the observation that all human efforts to make fundamental changes is attempting to raise fruit without trees. It's attempting to pluck an apple from the thin air. There can never be new fruit without new roots. There can never be fundamental change in humans because humans can't change themselves. The reason we have a hard time with this is because we don't like the feeling of helplessness that comes with it. The feeling of desperation. I've had people explaining this, I've explained this truth to, red-faced at me. There must be something I can do. No. No, there's not. Nothing. Why else does Jesus use the language of birth? Think about it. Think back to your birth. How much did you contribute to that? No, you were just along for that wild ride. None of us did. That's why Jesus uses that language. You can't contribute anything. And that is what Jesus is wanting Nicodemus to see. This is what he wants to blow open in his mind. It's actually what God has wanted his people to see for a very, very long time. That's why in verse 5, Jesus restates it with different important words. He says in verse 5, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Now notice that's a parallel statement to what he just said in verse 3. So Jesus is restating what he just said. You can't enter unless you're born from above. But this time, instead of born from above, he uses the language of water and the Spirit. And as Nicodemus, as he goes on in verse 10 to say, is a teacher of Israel, Jesus is expecting that he's going to be picking up what he's throwing down and that he understands what he's alluding to. Because Jesus is not teaching anything that's not already found in the Old Testament and in those very promises that Nicodemus and Israel looked to. You see, in all those promises that they were aspiring towards and Israel was desiring, all the things they focused on was not all God promised. In fact, if we were to go back to the book of Ezekiel 36, where we see a lot of these promises, God promised not just to liberate them, to give Israel a king and a universal kingdom. He promised to remake his people. Listen to verses 25 and 26 of Ezekiel 36. "I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleannesses. And from all your idols, I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh." Verse 5, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit." You see what Jesus is doing? Reverend Dr. Nicodemus, you ever read Ezekiel? Are you listening to me? Nicodemus and many others had ignored the spiritual transformation essential to entering into God's kingdom and what even entering God's kingdom meant to be remade new. Water indicates purification and cleansing. The sprinkling and washing of water was symbolic throughout the Old Testament to refer to forgiveness and cleansing and restoration. And Spirit refers to empowerment and transformation, a new life, a new heart with flesh, as new desires that feels and seeks towards God. And it's clear, even as you listened as I read, I'm sure it was clear, that this is God's work. How often, I will. Just like birth. The person is acted upon and is totally passive. They're not acting. God's people wanted deliverance, but totally ignored the conditions for entering God's kingdom and that God was the one who had to do it. That they had to be purified of their sin. They needed spiritual life that wasn't theirs to worship and follow God. That's why Jesus tells Nicodemus in verse 7, "You shouldn't be shocked. I told you you have to be born from above. You've read Ezekiel. You know what he says." But Nicodemus and Israel had grabbed God's promises and ignored all of them. Just grabbed the ones they liked. We do that all the time, don't we? We're quick to underline God's deliverances. Like Revelation 21, verse 4, among the most precious in the Bible, that in the end, in the new heaven and new earth, he will wipe away every tear from our eye, and death will be no more. But you know, there's another promise there, four verses later. the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, the murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. We probably don't spend as much time on that promise, do we? That every tear will be wiped away, but only for those who have faith in him. Not the faithless, not the idolaters. To them comes the second horrendous death. We have, beloved, a terrifying filter we need to be aware of. And it's our self-absorption in sin, our pride. And it'll deceive us. We'll listen to God's word, but only hear what we want. We have selective hearing, a self-deception that will choke out truth and life from us. If there's a virtue that our lives depend on, it must be teachability to the word of God, a humility before all his word. And that's even one of the great purposes God has given his church, to be a community where teaching is encouraged and right understanding is helped. That's even though this conversation is unique, certainly here between Jesus and Nicodemus, at the end of the day, Jesus is really trying to help Nicodemus understand his Bible. Nicodemus, you don't understand these things. You should. You're a ruler and teacher, but you're not understanding these things. And that's God's great gift to giving us a community of people who, however imperfectly, are called to instruct and correct and encourage one another from his word. Because left to ourselves, we will deceive ourselves, because we all are afflicted in various different ways by self-deception, hearing what we want and filtering out what we don't. And so Jesus here is loving Nicodemus. He is showing great care for him. He's reaching to Nicodemus and trying to change his questions. Instead of asking, what should we do to see God's kingdom, Nicodemus should have been asking him, what would it look like if God had done what he promised? If God was doing his promises, what would that look like? That's what Jesus reiterates in verse 8. He uses this illustration to explain, just like you can't control or restrain the wind, but you know when it's blowing, the same is true for those who are born of the Spirit. You can't control it, you can't restrain it, but just like rustling leaves when the wind is blowing, you know when it happens. You know what it looks like. Yet Nicodemus in verse 9 is still incredulous. How can this happen? How can this be? And that's where Jesus in verse 10 just rebukes him. You're a teacher? You don't get this? You don't understand these things? The truth's still not landing for you? We all struggle here at the same place as Nicodemus, don't we? We have best-selling books, Christian books in our country, with titles like How to Be Born Again. The whole point of the conversation is there's no how-to. That's what Jesus is driving at. Because we think there's something we can do. And the problem is, beloved, Nicodemus's problem, our problem, it's a universal problem. We have far too much hope. Far too much hope. Now, that may seem weird to say, and even weird when we look at our lives and the world around us. There's suffering, tragedy, despair, hardship everywhere. So to say we have far too much hope may seem checked out or even cruel. Life is hard. We need more hope. What do you mean we don't have enough? But over and over again, Jesus tells those he talks to, like Nicodemus, you're not hopeless enough, friend. You're not hopeless enough. What's the first thing that Jesus wants for us? The first thing he wants us to do? To lose hope. He wants to spark desperation in those he's talking to. That hope in themselves, the idea of a way out, that there's some way that we can fix this, he wants that all crushed. Beloved, you must be born from above is not good news. It's bad news. It's really, really bad news. And Jesus says that to help us grasp our real plight. John Calvin certainly got it right when he said, being born from above means we need a renewal of our entire nature. And that means there's nothing in us that's not defective. You don't need to just be reformed. You don't need just some bad habits change. You don't need some just religion slapped over your life. You need to be brand new. And in case you haven't noticed in yourself and those around you, ain't nobody can make themselves brand new. Renew their nature. By Jesus driving at this point, you must be born from above. Jesus wants us to look at ourselves and despair. He wants us to look at ourselves and lose hope. He wants desperation to spark. He wants us to feel our helplessness, our absolute helplessness. Because until you're brought to absolute desperation, you don't look for deliverance. And that's what he's driving at. He's wanting Nicodemus and us to listen to his word and to be desperate. And that brings us to the second part of this conversation, beginning in verse 11, looking for deliverance. Getting down to desperation, you might begin to look up. Nicodemus is stuck here, confused, and he's really hindered by his pride. And that's what Jesus then confronts in verse 11. They won't receive his testimony. And if, verse 12, he's telling him about earthly things, that is how God can change and must change the human heart on earth, how could he ever discuss heavenly things? You want to sit around and talk about eschatology, Nicodemus? You want to talk about the coming and the new heavens and the new earth? But you need gospel 101. And if you don't believe me when I tell you these things, how could you ever sit and talk in the rarefied air of how God is bringing his promises to pass? Because you're not believing me. And then Jesus in verse 13 reiterates that actually his word on these is absolutely final because it's experiential. Because verse 13, no one has ascended into heaven. You've not gone up there except the one who's come down from heaven, the Son of Man. Here's a clue. I'm not just a rabbi. I'm not just a prophet come from God. He's God's Son, the second person of the triune God made flesh. God is a man. And he didn't come from heaven just to teach. There's way, way more in verse 14. Jesus again takes Nicodemus back to his Bible, this time not the prophets, but the book of Numbers, the law. He takes him to an event in Israel's history that he knew but hadn't thought through enough. And you could perhaps read it later today or some other time you have time, Numbers chapter 21. What happened in Numbers 21? Well, in the entire book of Numbers, God's people are in the desert, the wilderness, wandering around. Why are they wandering in the desert? Because they didn't trust God. They got to the promised land. God did everything, was faithful to them, brought them out of slavery in Egypt, brought them right on the borders of the promised land, and they didn't trust him to take them all the way through, to take the land and to possess it. But instead of ending Israel in judgment, God showed mercy, and only that generation would perish in the wilderness, but their children would be brought from him into the promised land. So that's what's going on in Numbers. They're wandering around waiting for a generation to die in the wilderness. But that's by the mercy of God. God had redeemed them from slavery, had mercifully preserved them. He provided them with miraculous bread from heaven, manna that came down, and yet God's people complained. They complained as God wonderfully delivered them, showed mercy again and again. They grumbled. So in Numbers 21, God in judgment sent fiery serpents. He set snakes among the camp in judgment to bite the people. And people were dying from the snake bites because what sinners deserve is death. So God is exercising his holiness to his people. Now maybe you're getting, as we're painting the backdrop here, why Jesus brings up this point in Israel's history with Nicodemus. Israel complained about mercy, just like Nicodemus, just like Israel in his day. just like us today. We suffer in life a lot. And yet all our suffering is because we're sinners. And so God has justly cursed our world for rebelling against him. But what do? We blame God for the curse we deserve and ignore the mercies that we don't. We sin all the time. 7 billion sinners on the planet, and yet they got up and had breakfast this morning. We gripe over God's punishment we deserve and ignore the patience and the mercy that we don't deserve. It proves we're sinners. It proves what the Bible says is true. It proves we're not desperate enough. But that's not the only reason Jesus took Nicodemus there to show the parallels between Israel in his day and Israel then. Even though there were serpents by God's justice, God's grace wasn't done with Israel. And in Numbers 21, the people come to Moses and confess, "We have sinned. Take away, pray for us and take away the serpents from us." They confessed and went to Moses. Moses went to the Lord and the Lord answered. And he had Moses fashion a bronze serpent and set it on a pole in the midst of the camp. And when anyone looked at the serpent, they would live through their snake bite and be healed. They just had to look. Israel was to look at a bronze serpent to be healed from serpent bites. They were to look at a symbol of their judgment, a symbol of what they deserved. So with their look at the bronze serpent, they were acknowledging that the serpents that had been sent in the camp were deserved. That was God's justice. And with a look, they admitted that God has the power to deliver just by trusting his word, doing what he says. He says, "Look at the pole and you'll be delivered." If you think about it, you're dying from a snake bite. Looking at an inanimate pole sounds nuts. But God says, "Look at a pole, you'll be delivered. Trust God, you'll be delivered." So by looking to the pole, Israel was to admit that only God had the power to deliver, and he would do it just by looking. Now you see, Jesus is drawing all this together for Nicodemus and for us. We're in a desperate condition in sin. We cannot deliver ourselves out of it. There's no training, there's no moral improvement, there's no resolution that makes up for sin or changes the sinner's nature. We're under God's judgment, and only God can deliver. Verse 14, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up." Who was the serpent always pointing to? It was always pointing to the one who descended from heaven, the one who's sitting before Nicodemus. And this phrase, "lift up," that's key. It means to be lifted up on the cross. This phrase, "the Son of Man be lifted up," refers to crucifixion. Jesus came to die, to be lifted up on the cross. And on that cross, he wouldn't just symbolize judgment and redemption, he would accomplish it. He would be lifted up to suffer in his death the wrath of his Father towards sinners, taking on his eternal person the eternal judgment of God that sin deserves. Lifted up to suffer. Lifted up to suffer in the place of sinners, so that sinners that trust God's promise that those who look to his Son will live, will be rescued. As he suffers in their place and rises again 3 days later from the grave to be their righteousness, to be the one to whom they can look and be delivered. God's Son as a man would suffer eternal death on the cross so that eternal death would never be suffered by the sinners who trust him and who look to him. They'd be restored to God. They'd be forgiven and rescued. Now put this together here in this conversation. Jesus has just spent over a dozen verses driving Nicodemus into helplessness. You have to be born from above. You have to be made new. and God has to do it, there's nothing you can do. You are hopeless in yourself. You are helpless in yourself. You'd better be desperate. You're not desperate enough. What do I do? You just look. You just look. As the Son of Man is, as Moses lifted up the serpent, so the Son of Man must be lifted up. Verse 15, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. What does it mean to believe in him? It means to look. Look to the Son. Just look to him. Look to the Christ who went to the cross to suffer your judgment, to suffer what you deserve. Look. Trust that only God can deliver and that he has the power to deliver, to forgive. It's his promises. This is what Jesus is lovingly holding out, that all who believe in him are rescued from his justice and receive eternal life. Eternal life is not just life that never ends. It is new life with God. It's new life with him that begins now and does go forever with him in fellowship with him. Jesus is describing here what faith means. It's a look. It's looking to Christ in a desperate situation and trusting that only he can deliver. It's just a look. It's a life of looking. No longer looking to yourself, but looking to Christ. That the promise of God might be fulfilled just by looking to him, trusting him. Look to Christ. Friend, if you're here this morning, you're not a Christian, this is what it means to be a Christian. What it means to be a Christian, to have faith, is to look to Christ for rescue, to look for him alone, to no longer look to ourselves, to no longer look to others, to no longer look to any other schemes or ways to get out of our situation before God, but to look to Christ, to trust him and him alone. It's just a look, and all who trust him have eternal life. It's amazing. Christianity is not first about moral reform. It's not first about the commitments we have. It's first about looking to Christ. And that's actually how Christians keep living. It brings us to the third part here in verses 16 to 18. Living independence. Living independence. These verses, I'm sure most of all of us know, are among the most celebrated and quoted verses in all the Bible. You've at least seen the moniker John 3:16 at a football game or a sporting event. But as you can see, what they mean have everything to do with what's just come forward. And these verses are actually not part of Jesus' direct interaction and conversation with Nicodemus. This is John the Apostle's expansion or exposition of their conversation. He does it throughout the gospel where he'll pause and give expansion on what's going on so we don't miss it. John is explaining here the point of Jesus' conversation with Nicodemus and the Son of Man being lifted up. And really, once we understand now this conversation between Jesus and Nicodemus and where Jesus drives him, the meaning here of verses 16 and 18 just flower open for us. And really, what John is driving at here is that our look of faith is not just momentary. It's lifelong. This is how we live. We have here a look to a God of love. Look at how God has loved us. In verse 16, God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Now, we usually interpret in our culture, and we're discipled by our world, to interpret love as a just personal affirmation. It's a sentiment or emotion that we feel when things go the way we want and when others treat us the way we want. But here, God is clarifying for us true love. God so loved us, that is, God loved us in this way. What is love? He gave his only son. For what did he give him? Well, we've just seen that in verses 14. For our judgment, in our stead, in our place, God gave his son over that we would be brought to him. He gave his son, he says in verse 17, that the world might be saved through him, that might be rescued through him, might be brought out from under his judgment that we deserve. Do you see what John is driving at? That this interaction with Nicodemus isn't even just about Israel and God. It's about everybody. It's about the whole world. The whole world is like Israel in the desert. Israel in the desert is a microcosm of humanity and the human condition. Receiving God's just curse and blaming him for it. Receiving his unending mercies like manna from heaven and ignoring him over it. That's all of us. That's the whole world. That's everyone. And yet God has shown his love. He's shown his love to the whole world. The world, in verse 18, he says and clarifies, that is condemned already. We stand and we are born under judgment because of our sin, because we refuse God and take his things and want to live however we want. But God, the God who set a pole in the middle of the camp of Israel, set his son in the middle of the world. And that anyone from any tribe, tongue, or people, or nation that looks to the son is rescued, is saved, is brought out from under the condemnation that is already on every head on this planet. Friend, we have a God of love. Real, just, holy love. God has given us true love, offering us eternal life. We who are already under a sentence of eternal death and condemnation, that second death, we already own it when we're born. And yet God has lovingly set life before us. I hope this helps you like it helps me really look at how I view God. So much grumbling, so much complaining, so much questioning of a God of love. The great challenge in so many of our lives is we cannot seem to believe or be confident of God's love. And it's often because we don't look to it in Christ. God loved us this way. He sent his son. Our situations here, no, they're very far from perfect. But there's a pole in the camp. And those who look to him live. God of love. John Owen, one of my favorite phrases from John Owen, the greatest sorrow and burden you can lay on God the Father, the greatest unkindness you can ever do to him, is not believe he loves you. God is glorified as he holds out his son and we receive his love and we worship him as a God of love. We live looking in dependence to a God of love. And we live not just looking to a God of love, but looking to him constantly in dependence on his son. God sent his son to suffer for us, verse 16, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. With a look, we have eternal life just by believing in him. It's a look to Christ. Trusting him, relying on him, dependent upon him. And what's key to understand here in this verse and throughout the Bible, it's not momentary, it's not a decision, it's a look that never ceases. We keep trusting him. You could translate this very justifiably in verse 16, that all who are believing, all who keep on trusting, those who look to Christ and keep on looking, we look to him for deliverance, daily, constantly. It's not a decision at one point in life. It's a life of dependence and looking at Christ, a constant reliance upon him. Because looking to him, we have an answer for everything that troubles us before God. We have an answer when we're paralyzed by guilt, when we're frozen in our condemnation, our fear and despair, when we realize we are really who God says we are. What do? We look to Christ. You just look. In Christ, we also have an answer to trusting ourselves. On my best days, when I'm tempted to pride and arrogance, I look to Christ and I find the symbol of my judgment and what I deserve. And my best days, they've merited nothing before God. Only Him, only by looking to Christ, I could never be accepted by what I do or what I've done. And on my worst days, I look to Christ as He was lifted on the cross for my rescue, and I'm comforted that God has sent His Son for me, and God has accepted me regardless of what I've done because of what His Son has done, and because I look to Him. By looking to Christ, I have what does battle with both my pride and my self-loathing, and they're all brought under Him. Or even when I'm walking in life and God's commands, they just seem so unsatisfying. It just really would be a lot better if I could be trusted with my own joy and happiness. That this immorality, really, you're telling me leaving off this is the path to joy? It doesn't feel like it. Indulging in this anger, really, that's not going to bring me what I want? But what do? I look to Christ, and I know that the God who sent His Son for me in love, He can be trusted with every single command He gives. Every single one comes from this God, a God of love. So even when His commands and my obedience seem like a hard road, I know it's the road of love, because He's loved me in this way by sending His Son, that by looking to Him, I'd have eternal life. It's been said, usually in derision or mockery, well, that Jesus is just a crutch. God is a crutch. That's not true at all. He's not just a crutch. He's life support. I'm attached to Him with wires, and I depend to breathe upon Jesus. Crutch doesn't go far enough. I live in dependence upon Him. One of our great missionary heroes is John Payton. He was missionary to the New Hebrides as an island of cannibals. I encourage you to read his autobiography if you haven't. He was trying to explain and share the gospel there among the natives, and he was especially looking for a word in their language for faith, belief. It's a hard concept to bring across. And one day, after he had gone out hunting with some of the natives, he was so exhausted that he just threw himself into a chair beside his tent. And one of the natives observed, "Well, it's good to stretch out and rest when you're tired." And then he had it. Payton went on to translate every occurrence of belief in the New Testament with the native language for stretch out and rest. Because exactly what faith and belief is getting at. Faith is relying, resting, looking to Christ. It's stretching out and resting on Him. It's listening to what His Word says and realizing we are desperate and hopeless in ourselves. It's looking to Him and Him alone and realizing only resting in Him is their deliverance. And it's living a life that never moves from that posture, looking to Him, trusting Him, stretching out and resting on Jesus Christ. Do you live with your gaze fixed on Christ? Look to Him. Trust Him. Even stretch out and rest on Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank You that Your Word is so profitable for us, that a nighttime conversation 2,000 years ago would shed bright lights into our lives today. And we pray that Your Spirit would shed abroad the light of Your Son into all of our hearts. And we pray, Father, there would be none who would leave here this morning that are not resting upon Your Son, looking to Him to save, and by Your Spirit living constantly dependent on Him. We love You, Father, but our love could never merit Yours. And we pray that You would help us live more humbly, contritely, and trustingly upon You in Jesus Christ. And we thank You, Father, that You have not just sent judgment, but You have put a pole in the camp, and we can look to Him and be rescued. We praise You, and we thank You. In Jesus' name, amen.